Hey, everybody, it's Ryan. Thanks for downloading today's show. And just a reminder, as always, Wake Up War Chant is brought to you by our friends at For the Table, Madison Social, Central and Township, in the heart of College Town.
Good morning, Tallahassee. Time for Wake Up War Chant on 97.9 ESPN Radio.
Gentlemen, from Tallahassee to Thomasville and from coast to Atlantic coast, it's time to Wake Up War Chant here on 97.9 ESPN Radio, and it's a very happy Thursday morning, July the 20th. Is it really July the 20th already? Jeez. To you and yours. Sorry about that. I honestly, I did not pre-plan doing that or anything. It is just kind of crazy that it's July 20th. This year has flown. I feel like we haven't been doing this live for that long. Like I feel like it's maybe been a month or two, and yet here we are. We started this in the middle of February, this grand experiment that I know we've enjoyed. I hope you've enjoyed, and I think it's going to be a lot of fun in the future. You're currently listening to the voice of Ryan Kelly. I'm the director of digital media at warchant.com. Drew Hickens on the other side of the glass. Drew, does it feel like we've been doing this for almost half a year now?
Yes and no. Yes, in the sense of continuing to wake up at 5. No, in the sense that it doesn't feel like it's been that long.
No, and I think things are always like that, in that when you look back at something, you're like, man, that doesn't seem like it was too long ago. And then you remember something that happened around that time, and you think to yourself, man, that feels like it was forever ago. So time's weird, man, and the way we process it's really weird. Sorry, I didn't mean to go all weird McConaughey in a Lincoln commercial at the beginning of the show, but just a thought. Hey, thanks for waking up with us here at 6 a.m. on 97.9 ESPN Radio. Talk a little FSU sports and all things around it. Or maybe, just maybe, were your wake-up call to watch a little bit of the Open, in which case, good morning. Nice to talk to you. We got a treat for you tomorrow, so you might want to hold on for that. But thanks so much for waking up with us here at 6 on 97.9, or, of course, streaming on the TuneIn radio app or the WTSM app. Apps, iTunes, Podcast Republic, you know where you can get your podcast by now. You can get it on just about any place where fine podcasts are. Now you can get us on YouTube as well. Make sure to rate and subscribe us if you like the show. Leave us a good review. It helps us out and helps you out when you subscribe to that show and you're not looking for us every day. Then, of course, that email address is radio@warchant.com. At Wake Up Warchant is your Twitter account if you like to do things directly through that way. If you want to vote in our Decades of Dominance poll, I'll tell you, you've only got about an hour or two left, and then that bad boy is shut down for the year. We're going to post the full team today. Thanks for voting. Thanks for playing along. I think we've had some fun discussions and some fun debates about that. But there's been a not-so-fun discussion and a rather interesting discussion for Florida State, and more specifically, hashtag FSU Twitter over the last 24 hours. There are some folks who are not very excited about the Dodd Trophy watch list, and I can understand why. Of course, the Dodd Trophy is given to the best coach in college football, according to the Chick-fil-A Bowl, who's given this thing out for quite some time. Established in 1976, been around for quite some time. Watch list came out yesterday. Jimbo Fisher's not on that watch list. And I don't think people are necessarily upset about that, because you know what? Sometimes good coaches are not on this watch list. But the problem is there are a good little handful of coaches that when they're on the list and you're not on the list, it kind of raises an eyebrow. And it might kind of makes you go, what? Really? Are you sure about that? And, you know, it is very, very hard for coaches at power programs to win Coach of the Year. It's very, very hard for Jimbo Fisher, especially inside conference, to win a Coach of the Year style award. It's hard for a Coach K to win a Coach of the Year. It was hard for Pete Carroll to win Coach of the Year. I actually haven't fact-checked that, so don't look that one up on me. But you get what I'm trying to say. When you're at a power program, you're expected to be good. You're expected to get results. You're expected to win 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 games. That's just kind of what's expected of you. That's the outcome that a lot of people think is going to happen. But here's the problem. A lot of people think Nick Saban is going to have that result. He's on this list. A lot of people think Urban Meyer's going to have that result. He's on that list. A lot of people think Clay Helton's going to have that result. He's on that list. So you're surrounded by guys who are kind of in that tier of program. Maybe not that tier of coach, because, I mean, Clay Helton, as much as we all liked what USC did at the end of the year, hasn't proved that he's kind of in that category. That he's still got some – but the problem is when you're Jimbo Fisher and Paul Stinkin' Crist is on this list, when James Franklin is on this list, when Butch Jones is on this list, Paul Johnson is on this list, David Shaw, who, you say what you want about Stanford, but they perennially disappoint, is on this list. Ken Niumatalolo from Navy is on this list. Bill Snyder, as much as you may like the Wizard, doesn't really belong on a list with Jimbo Fisher, especially in this stage in his career. There's just a lot of guys on this list that you think to yourself, huh? Really? Okay.
Yeah, I think you brought up a good point. It's just, it's hard for the guys who have already done it and have been there to get on lists like this. Even though Saban and Meyer and all of them are on there, they won't win. Because once you've reached the pinnacle of college football, I think people then begin to expect it, and they don't take your good seasons for what they once did. A guy like Clay Helton could easily win it because USC hasn't been there in a while. And they won the Rose Bowl last year, but he hasn't proven that he can go there and win a national title yet. If he went and went 13-0, 12-0 with USC, guess who's probably going to win that? Him. And then, you know, you bring up the guys like Shaw from Stanford. Again, hasn't won a national title. It's a lot of these guys who are, even if you're at a decently large program, if you haven't gone on to win a title or brought your team to the top, I think you have a better chance of winning things like this because you have room for improvement instead of kind of, well, it's a national title or bust every year. And I think that's where Jimbo Fisher gets lost in the shuffle sometimes, is because so many people expect so much from Florida State. They expect them to go 11-1 every year, which is unrealistic at a lot of times, but especially back when the ACC was seen in kind of a bad light, they think, oh, well, why isn't Florida State just running roughshod through the ACC every year? That's something Jimbo Fisher should do when he has 20 kids on the preseason lists, you know? And so I understand it. I also understand why it's frustrating. I think for me, the bigger gripe is how he hasn't won ACC Coach of the Year as opposed to Coach of the Year. I think 2013 and 2014, and even last year, he could have won it, but you understand why Dabo got it. And, you know, it's just tough. It's tough. These things are so – there's so much – almost it feels like there's so much politics that go into it.
Oh, absolutely.
It's just it's always hard to pinpoint exactly what it is, but those are just a few of my kind of theories.
The fact that Dabo's won Coach of the Year and Jimbo hasn't. And listen – people are still kind of upset about that in 2013. But if you're not going to vote for Jimbo Fisher in a year where he takes Florida State to a national championship, there better be a pretty darn good reason. And somebody somehow inexplicably getting Duke to win 10 games is a decent reason. I understand Florida State laid the wood to Duke in that ACC title game. But as far as excuses to not vote for somebody goes, Cutcliffe doing that with Duke, I think, is a fair enough one. And I know not everyone will agree with me on that. But, I mean, when you think about what Duke football is historically, when you think about what they've done, I don't care how bad the Coastal is. The fact that you got guys to Duke that could put together 10 wins is pretty impressive.
Right. The overall perception of it is, obviously, is it's hard to vote for a guy who had a 2013 team who pretty much was – it was pretty much an NFL team. I mean – you saw the entire defensive side of the balls in the league. I'm pretty sure close to the entire offensive side, if not the – I mean, the whole team was just filled of NFL-caliber players.
Yeah.
And obviously that wasn't the case at Duke, and you're looking at a team who's still playing in the ACC title game. And I think for a lot of people, they just think, like I said, they just – well, Florida State should be that good. They look at all the guys that they have. What is – a lot of people just don't understand, obviously, how much a goes into being – a head coach and things like that, and how a team can just go, and you've seen it now. You've seen it now how even with the talent, things can still not go your way. So much falls on a head coach's shoulders. I think it's tough. I think it's tough, but you do understand at times when the Georgia Techs and the Dukes and the NC States go and win 10, 11 games, why FSU winning 10 or 11 games just isn't as impressive as them doing that.
Well, I think it's also the idea to someone who would want to counterpoint you. It's just like, well, you know, if that's expected, why did Dabo Swinney win Coach of the Year last year? When in reality, you know, I think last year, honestly, Jimbo Fisher was a decent candidate for Coach of the Year just because, I mean, and we've talked about it on this show before, they really saved that season from going way south. After that NC State game, the North Carolina game, you're going on the road to Miami. That extra point doesn't happen. You go to overtime. You lose. There's no telling where that season goes. There's no telling what Florida State's record is. I do think that it's a highly impressive coaching job, maybe one of Jimbo's best ever, that he was able to keep that thing from sinking last year. And then, of course, rebounds, plays in a New Year's Six Bowl, beats the Michigan Wolverines, who a lot of people thought would be playing for a national title.
Yeah, I 100% agree with you. I think last year was probably the best coaching job of his career, in my opinion, just with all the adversity the team was given and things like that. But, again, it's back to the point that, you know, Clemson hadn't been to the pinnacle of college football since 1981. They had one title. Clemson's not seen in the same light as Florida State in a lot of people's minds.
But Clemson had played for a title the year before.
But they didn't win. So there was still, technically speaking, there's still room to improve. They go and they beat Alabama, which is no tough task. Saban doesn't really lose national title games. And I think that's where you see the difference is the overall perception of Clemson's program versus Florida State's program. I just don't think in a lot of people's mind it was the same. As fair or not fair that may be, I just think that that's the reality of the situation, is that Florida State was seen by many, you know, 14 years in a row of top five finishes, two national titles, this and that. Well, Clemson hadn't done a ton in a while. And I think you had seen that a lot of people felt like Dabo brought that back. And you could argue that Jimbo brought that back too. But I just think that it's a little bit different as far as the perception goes as to why maybe Dabo got that award.
Preseason watch list to me, at least for the Dodd Trophy. Whoever gets the Dodd Trophy, it's usually one of two people. It's one, a guy who has a very, very good program that is expected to take a step back, a perennial kind of on the door of the playoffs or knocking on the door, that lost a lot of talent, but somehow found a way to get back in that conference title hunt, somehow found a way to get back into that playoff or the New Year's Six or something of that nature. That, to me, screams a Jim Harbaugh type guy who is going to lose every single starter on defense. If he somehow corrals them to a Big Ten title and a playoff spot, he's a guy who could get a Coach of the Year type thing, despite the program that he's at. The other guy is the guy that has consistently good, not great program. You know, 10, 11 wins a year. If he takes that step forward, if he wins that conference, he gets them into the playoffs, a Mike Gundy or a Kyle Whittingham type. Those are the two types of folks that I think are usually up for these Coach of the Year awards, the overachievers and the guys who are able to hold steady despite circumstances.
Yeah, I agree. I also think another aspect of it is first-year coaches at big programs.
That's fair, too.
If you have a guy come in like Tom Herman at Texas and he wins 9 or 10 games, that's a pretty good candidate for that. And obviously, it's like you said, the overachievers, the Power 6 guys who go and win 11 or 12 games. Those are always a good candidates, but if you're at a bigger program, a lot of the time, the easiest way I would say to win the Dodd Trophy would probably be if you're a Clay Helton or somebody like that, first year coach, or like you said, expected maybe to take a little step back, and that's how you go and you win that when you're at a bigger school like that.
And that's the thing, and that's kind of why sometimes watch lists are silly. And it was funny. Asher Wildman on WCTV, my buddy, we talked about this after he got off the air, but he even said it on a sportscast last night. You know, there's a certain sense of silliness to watch lists, because how many times has the Heisman gone to somebody we didn't even think would be on the radar when the season started? Nobody knew who Johnny Manziel was at the beginning of the 2012 season. Nobody knew who Jameis Winston was outside of the folks who watched that spring game in the 2013 season. And especially the people who did know him, despite how much they liked him, there weren't a lot of folks saying, you know, I think a freshman's going to win the Heisman. I think it's time to do that for the second year in a row. There were not a lot of folks screaming or beating that drum. And I think a lot of folks would have looked at you weird before either of those two happened. And, I mean, there's plenty of other places down the line. What was it? It's 2011. Remember the preseason? All hail the great and powerful Andrew Luck. We may as well just mail him the Heisman. He's the greatest quarterback in the history of ever since Unitas. So we may as well just do, oh, Robert Griffin III's really good too. Oh, I guess we got to give him the trophy. These things never turn out the way these watch lists want them to. Never, ever, ever, ever. And it kind of makes you think, between this list of Paul Chryst, James Franklin, Fuente, Gundy, Harbaugh, Helton, Johnson, Butch Jones, Malzahn, McElwain, Meyer, Neomatololo, Peterson, Richt, Saban, Shaw, Snyder, Sweeney, or Whittingham, you taking one of those dudes to win this thing, or are you taking the field?
Because
that's a tough question.
It is a tough question because I think there's a lot of guys in there who are fully capable. Especially
and there are. It's not a bad list.
Right,
it just has a couple glaring omissions. I think Lincoln Riley is an omission on this list.
I think here's a really good example of the point you were trying to make of a team supposedly going to take a step back that maybe won't is Virginia Tech. They lost a lot of people. I really, really like Fuente. You know, if he were to go and take that next step forward all of a sudden with Virginia Tech, a team who hasn't been there recently and also is expected to take a step back, that's a guy who could easily win that award. I think obviously there's a lot of good candidates on there, but it would probably be smarter if you were to bet on this to take the field, just because, like you said, you never know, and it's nothing but a preseason watch list. And there's almost something that goes to the guy who goes out and does it who wasn't on the preseason watch list that I almost feel like boosts him up a little bit. As weird as that sounds, like I said, there's so many aspects to these awards, and like you said, the watch lists, they mean nothing. I mean, how often do you hear people talk about their accolades and say, well, I was a preseason All-American, or I was on this preseason watch? Like, no one cares. It's all about what they're going to do during the year and things like that, and we'll see. But I think if I had to choose, I would probably take the field.
You know, I kind of feel bad for Mike Gundy in this situation because I already brought him up. And, of course, folks who listen to the show for a long time know that I like me some Mike Gundy. But I feel bad for him here in that, you know, if Oklahoma State made the playoffs this year and Bob Stoops was still the coach at Oklahoma, he'd probably win an award like this very, very easily. However, because Lincoln Riley's a first-year head coach, if Lincoln Riley wins the Big 12, and with all the talent that Oklahoma still has, and they somehow make the playoffs, he's going to get coach of the year, no question, and he's going to be called a boy genius and a boy prodigy and all that. However, if Gundy wins it, it's going to be, well, big deal, you beat a first-year head coach at Oklahoma and a first-year coach at Texas. I mean, I know that's sometimes just the way the world works, but, you know, I would take this list maybe over the field just because I'm with you. There's enough of those surprise names to where it'll work. I don't know. I don't think this is a bad list by any stretch of the imagination, but you can't be leaving out names like Jimbo Fisher. If you are, you got to start leaving out the Myers and the Sabins of the world, because that just doesn't make any sense to me that you can reward the guy who's been the head coach of Alabama and the juggernaut they've become and not the head coach of Florida State. I mean, and that's not to tell you that Florida State is, you know, right there 1A and 1B with Alabama. I'm not trying to say that. I'm not trying to stoke message board material. I'm just saying it doesn't make any sense.
I agree. I think the only reason why you see the Saban and the Meyer up there is just because how often they've been in the playoff and how Saban, as good as Alabama is, the fact that he keeps them near the top every single year is just insane. I mean, you're looking at a guy who almost went back-to-back titles again. You know, there's no slouching, but I get what you're saying. Obviously, if you're going to include those guys, like, you would expect Jimbo to be in there at least. Was Dabo on the list, by the way?
Yes, Dabo was on this
list. Yeah, so, I mean, we're talking at this point, it's almost like, well, what's the deal? But, you know, who knows? Like I said, there's so many things that go in there. I don't know.
It is what it is, but if Florida State is very, very convincing throughout this season, especially if they, say, beat Alabama and Clemson in the same season, I'd say he gets on that watch list sooner rather than later.
I think he would have a good chance to win it if they ran through the schedule that they have this year. There's three or four really tough games on there. If you were to go and win all of those, including Alabama, I think you'd have a pretty good shot at him winning that.
It's not quite last year's gauntlet, but it certainly starts with a heck of a bigger boom, and that's no offense to Ole Miss. Let's get you caught up on all the things that have happened over the last 24 hours in the world of sports. This, my friends, is While You Were Sleeping.
Hello. Good morning.
Wake up! Wake up!
Wake me up!
Good morning. Good morning.
What happened last night?
We start in the world of the Gold Cup, actually, where the United States defeated El Salvador 2-0 last night. Wanted to go ahead and talk about that for a little bit, and that was a quarterfinal clash. Of course, the United States will advance to the semis now, but a lot of the soccer experts not exactly thrilled about how they've played. Kind of lethargic, kind of just kind of going through the motions, but it is what it is, and congratulations to the Yanks as we move on to the semifinal. I think it's great. That's why I love international soccer. International soccer is the one place where I feel like just about anyone as a member of the media or whatever is just allowed to be an unabashed homer and nobody cares. Everybody's allowed to be a United States fan. It just kind of is what it is. Because you love America, don't you? Well, don't you? Exactly. Major League Baseball, 8-2, the Cubbies over the Braves in Atlanta. It's 6-1, the Twins beat the Yankees 4-1. Seattle over Houston at Minute Maid Park, 18-4. Ooh. Sorry, Padres, that's how many the Rockies put on you last night in Colorado. 7-2, Oakland holds serve at home over the Tampa Bay Rays. 7-3, it's the New York Metropolitans getting it done over the St. Louis Cardinals. 3-2 in 10 innings, that's what it took for the Buccos to stave off the Milwaukee Brewers at home. Boston gets themselves a big W last night over the Toronto Blue Jays, 5-1. The Dodgers go to Chicago and beat the White Sox 9-1 in 8 innings. 7-0, that's the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim over the Washington Nationals. We got a little bit more to talk about right on the other end, including some Jimbo Fisher camp, so stay tuned. We got a little bit more on that. Wake Up War Chant, 97.9 ESPN Radio.
Wake Up War Chant on 97.9 ESPN Radio is presented by TNT Golf Cart Supercenter, your one-stop shop for all your outdoor entertainment. Here's Ryan Kelly.
Page of warchant.com right now. If you like recruiting, it is the place to be. Of course, the second Jimbo Fisher high school football camp of the year going on right now. Second and final, I should say that. But overall, there's a lot of good stuff to digest. Michael Langston's done a good job. The tentative schedule is to have him on tomorrow to kind of put things as close to a wrap up as we possibly can. Hoping to have him on tomorrow. Hoping to have Asher Wildman on tomorrow to talk about some of the Noles over there at the British Open. Be nice to get both of them on, talk about it. That, again, that's the tentative schedule. Hope to have both of those guys tomorrow. And if we don't get Asher on tomorrow, we're most certainly going to have him on Monday to wrap things up. And same goes with Michael. But I think we're going to get them both tomorrow. So just hang on. Bear with us there. But as I mentioned, it is Jimbo Fisher camp. There are guys there. I will say this. Michael seems to be decently confident that we get a Justin Fields sighting at this camp. I don't know. Once again, I can't talk for him, I can't speak for him, but getting him on campus as much as you can is a very, very, very good thing, even if it's not a quote-unquote official visit.
Justin Fields has been a very, very busy guy over the past couple of weeks. He's gone to Georgia and Auburn. I know Alabama has recently entered the mix as well. I really, really feel like this is turning into a Florida State-Georgia battle. Just from what I've seen and what I've read, I think it's going to be tough to pry him out of Georgia's hands. I think our biggest ally might be Jimbo, obviously, just trying to convince him that, listen, here's what I can do with you. Here's what I've done with quarterbacks in the past. And look at the guys that you have ahead of you here versus the guys ahead of him at Georgia. Georgia has recently brought in 2 5-stars at quarterback the last 2 years. It makes a lot more sense for him to come to Florida State. But I think at the same time, it's always tough sometimes to pry a kid from that home state school. But if you get him here this week on something that's not even an official visit, that would be huge, because then you're feeling really good about your chances to get him on campus again after that. And I think that camp session he had with Jimbo still looms pretty large in his mind when he thinks about how quickly and easily Jimbo was able to kind of critique him and help him with his balls.
You know, you talk about Georgia, of course. Kirby Smart has done nothing but a good job since he took over that job, hitting that recruiting trail, being very, very good in what he does there. But you're right, Georgia has brought in depth at quarterback. And right now, I mean, no offense to our boy JJ, but when you're rolling in with JJ Cosentino as your second string quarterback this year, and oh yeah, he's gone after this year, you don't have a lot of depth. And I know you're hoping James Blackman's going to turn into a good guy. I know you're hoping that Bailey Hockman's going to turn into a decent dude. But the thing is, you can't count on it. Justin Fields is about as close to a surefire count-on quarterback as you're going to get in today's college football recruiting. You know?
Yeah, I think it's hard to imagine a world where I think Frenchie's probably not gone after this year. But say he has 2 more good years, there's a very good chance he's gone after his junior year. And that's another thing to look at for Justin Fields. If he comes in and has to even redshirt a year, no big deal. Come in, learn the offense. Jimbo's shown, again, I think a lot of it is going to have to do with, I think he's going to closely watch Florida State and what they do with Francois and how the offense operates early in the year, because I do think this recruitment is going to push on a little bit into the season. And that's as a Florida State fan, that's what you want. Because if you get a tweet or an update that says Justin Fields is committing within the week, guess what? It's not us. So the longer that this goes on, the better it is for Florida State. Because I think right now there's a lot of momentum for Georgia. But the good news for all of us is it really, and knock on wood, because obviously it's recruiting and I don't know, it does seem like for a while Florida was the favorite. It seems like they've fallen off a little bit.
Florida's having trouble getting a quarterback. I can't tell you how shocked I am, Drew. It just blows my mind that a quarterback doesn't want to go play for Florida.
Right. It was something that really never made a lot of sense to a lot of people. Why would you take it upon your shoulders? A guy who's not even a Florida guy doesn't even... I would get it, you know, if you grew up a Florida fan, you love Florida, you really like McElwain, you have a bond with them, things like that. If you want to be the guy to try to be the next Tebow, whatever. But, I mean, you're not. That's not even something that's on your radar. So I don't even understand, as a top-tier quarterback, until McElwain can prove he can do something over there, there's just no way I would take that chance when I can go to places like Florida State, Bama, Georgia. It just doesn't – I don't get that.
Ole Miss had a hard enough time selling Cam Akers and that you have to be the savior of Ole Miss football. Try telling a kid who grew up in Kennesaw, what, an hour away from Athens – that you have to be the savior of Florida football. That ain't happening. I mean, listen, you can sell, you can try to get your guy all you want, because, I mean, we all know McElwain, until one of these dudes proves it, hasn't found his guy. Do you really think that 5-star elite talent is just going to go down there and say, you know, I want to throw to these receivers, who's he who and what's his face? I want to be behind this line. I know this defense that lost everybody is going to support me, including the coordinator. And again, that's not me trying to pile on, you know, on the rival radio show. But the thing is, you know, until Florida's proven otherwise, they're what they are. And I think Justin Fields saw that. And Florida State and Georgia, I feel like that's kind of also a similar argument for Georgia. Georgia's got to get over that hump, and Kirby Smart's got to prove that he can win a lot of games. And I do think he's going to be a better coach than what he was last year. But a lot of folks thought Georgia wasn't going to miss a beat. And I think part of that is because of the consistency that Mark Richt gave. we can complain and we can poke all we want that Mark Richt couldn't win divisions and he couldn't win conferences and he couldn't get himself in the title hunt on a regular basis. But to say that Georgia was anything shy of consistent was kind of mind-blowing. So I think in that term, Florida State sets itself up the best, but I also agree with you in that it can sometimes be difficult, especially when this is a North Florida guy. This isn't some kid at Thomasville High School. This isn't some kid in Valdosta or Lowndes. This is a kid who's played, like I said earlier, like an hour and a half away from Athens. And Georgia's got a new emphasis on recruiting, new head coach, lots of new shiny stuff over there. When, meanwhile, you kind of have to realize Florida State's been around. Florida State's established. Florida State has been at its current level under Jimbo Fisher for about 7-8 years now. And it's not quite as new, and it's not quite as flashy as it once was. I think Florida State always has a bit of flash to it. Kids always like the uniforms. Kids always like the spear. Kids always like the tradition of FSU. I'm not trying to say that. But what I am trying to say is Florida State's the more consistent thing, while Georgia's maybe the shiny new toy.
Yeah, I think the thing other than the location of Justin Fields that really kind of separates Georgia apart from Florida in my mind. And look, I get it. I'll probably catch some slack for this if somehow any Gator fans stumble across this show. I get that they've won the East the last 2 years, but the feeling around Georgia just seems so much different than the feeling around Florida. It's just, you know, there's a lot of momentum behind Georgia right now. They're getting a lot of recruits, and big-time guys want to go play there and want to play for Kirby Smart. And he's in the – and while, you know, McElwain only has another year under his belt or so, it hasn't looked pretty, and he's still not getting his guys. And there are
boosters who are just waiting for him to not win the East.
Right, and because really, I mean, that's been his argument. And he drives that home in every press conference where someone wants to talk down on him a little bit on how they've looked and how they've performed at times. We'll have won the East. What else do you want me to do? And to a certain extent, I understand that, and I do agree with him. But at the same time, if you're a guy who's his self-proclaimed quarterback guru from Colorado State, and you continuously cannot get your guy to come play for you, I don't care. You're never gonna bring Florida back to that level recruiting like that. And if he can't get things like that done, then it's just not gonna happen. And I think at Georgia, you just see all these five-star guys piling on top of each other. There's just a lot more momentum behind them. There's a lot more of a like you said, a shiny new toy feel of what can this turn into. And I think that's something to watch. But again, I think what we're looking at right now as far as Justin Fields' recruitment, in my mind, just the vibe I get, and I know nothing because none of us do. It's just recruiting. It feels like the kid's heart a little bit is with Georgia, but it feels like his mind, and he knows that maybe Florida State's the better fit in the overall choice. I think that's something he'll have to battle with, and something he'll have to, you know, a decision he'll have to make for himself at the end of the day. But we'll see.
It's a fight between two recruiting heavyweights for the best player in college football. Should be fun. More after this. It's Wake Up War Chant here on 97.9 ESPN Radio.
Florida State just landed a 5-star commitment.
I don't see that anywhere online. How did you get that news so fast?
I'm on the new WarChant.com app. I get news updates and scores pushed to my phone instantly.
How much does it cost?
It's free. Just go to iTunes or the Google Play Store, type in WarChant, and install it on your phone. That's it.
A free app that keeps me constantly up to date on Florida State sports and recruiting? Wow, that makes it incredibly easy to follow my Seminoles and never miss out.
With the app, you'll also get quick access to all the stories and features on WarChant, including the ever-popular message boards that feature thousands of fans talking about the Noles.
WarChant.com, your ultimate Seminole source.
Wake Up War Chant on 97.9 ESPN Radio is presented by TNT Golf Cart Supercenter, your one-stop shop for all your outdoor entertainment. Here's Ryan Kelly.
Football's in the air, ladies and gentlemen, and of course you can explain that by, well, the first teams of the NFL training camp reporting yesterday, and that includes in-state team, Jacksonville, and that includes an idiot like Dante Fowler Jr. And I've already got Drew chuckling. We're going to have some fun with this. And listen, I know a lot of Florida State fans have hard feelings towards Dante Fowler Jr., including many who are Jacksonville fans, about what he did to Florida State on National Signing Day. And they should, honestly, because that was an all-time kind of screw job. But you know what? Those were the actions of a teenage boy. And by the time that you're in your third season in the NFL, you shouldn't be a teenage boy anymore. You should be a man who's taken responsibility for what you do. You should be a man who's looking to give back to your community. You should be a man who's looking to grow and look for that second contract to where you can get that money and you can be set for life. You know what Dante Fowler Jr. has done since he has joined the National Football League? Absolutely none of that. He has not been the guy who is worthy of drafting over Khalil Mack. I didn't like that pick when it happened. I still don't like that pick. I know that's just kind of an easy thing to say on a day like this. But when you're as immature as throwing away a guy's booze and stepping over him because he cut you off on the road, really? When you're as immature as, you know, taking pot shots actually at our website on Twitter because we ran a most hated tournament. When you're as immature as, you know, the excuses and the whining and the whatever about, well, you know, I just feel like I should be. That's great. Well, while you've been doing that and while you've been playing Party Boy and while you've been playing Super Guy, there's this kid named Yannick Ngakoue, and he's passed you on the depth chart. Sorry, it's tough.
Yeah. First things first, I was actually talking about this with my friend the other day. While I do agree with you on Khalil Mack, that was actually who he should have taken instead of Bortles, not Fowler.
My bad.
But you're good.
I thought that was that draft.
I only know this because we've had so many busts. it's almost remarkable, really, how many top five picks we've had that don't work out. It's pretty crazy. But anyways, we should have taken Khalil Mack over Bortles, one. Two, we should have taken Amari Cooper or someone else over Fowler, two.
That was the Cooper draft, you're
right. And really, you know, but at the time, I'll give the Jaguars this at least. At the time, you understood the pick. It made sense. A guy who had a lot of production. Or I guess, you know what? I can't even say that. He didn't have a lot of production in college. He was just very disruptive. And I didn't hate the pick at the time. Obviously, I didn't love him because he was a Florida guy, but he was a Jaguar. So you know what? Fine. And he has been known to give the Jaguars coaches, you know, fits when they're thinking about who do I have to worry? Who's going to give me that phone call in the middle of the night? It's going to be Fowler. He's had multiple problems since he's entered the league. Just from people around Jacksonville that I know, I never hear good things about what he's doing. That's not to condemn the guy of anything. I'm just saying the word around him is not good.
He's not helping little old ladies across the street.
Right. The word around him is not good. The fight between his current girlfriend or child's mother or whatever happened on camera was not good. This is not good. And I've heard the arguments from both sides. A lot of people think it's funny and they think that it's good because we need quote unquote goons on our team. And you know what? To a certain extent, yeah, the Jaguars do need to be a little nastier. I understand that. But there's a time and place to be nasty, and throwing someone's groceries and stepping on their glasses isn't one of them.
I was about to say, there's a difference between being nasty and being stupid to a certain extent. You're not going to prove you're big and bad when you're a player in the National Football League and you're going to step on Joe Schmo's glasses. Like, that's playground bully nonsense. That's not showing that you have a mean streak.
Yeah, I think, and honestly, the other thing he's done that is baffling to me is this isn't even a guy who's doing all this on his second contract where he's made some money. He's doing it on his rookie contract where he's supposed to be having all these things to prove, and he hasn't proved a damn thing, like we've said. He hasn't done anything. And you're right, Yannick Ngakoue, a third-round pick who a lot of people speculated whether or not he was better than Dante, passed him on the depth chart, which many people thought wasn't going to happen just because of where Dante was drafted and the money you invested in him and things like that. You figured Dante had given the benefit of the doubt, and hopefully maybe they would have around the same production, and for that reason, Dante would be the guy. Yannick had a far better year last year. It is what it is. And I think you're looking – he's now – I mean, he's heading to Bust City. He's a bust in my mind. I don't have a lot more patience for this guy. I would let his rookie contract run out, and I'd probably send him on his way.
We're a couple 20-somethings who, you know, can sometimes turn a blind eye to stuff like this, who have run out of patience with Dante Fowler Jr. Imagine how Tom Coughlin feels about Dante Fowler Jr.
Yeah, this anybody who knows anything about Coughlin, he is a 100% no-nonsense kind of guy, which is why even drafting a guy like we've talked about on here before, when we drafted D.D. Westbrook, I gotta admit, I was a little surprised. I didn't hate the pick. Matter of fact, I liked it. But knowing Tom, a little surprised. I knew for that reason that if we didn't go Fournette in the first round, we weren't going Mixon. I was almost 100%, 150% positive that Tom Coughlin was not going to pick Joe Mixon. And I don't think Tom Coughlin would have picked Dante Fowler third, because I think there was already a lot of smoke around him and his character at Florida. This is one of those things. It's super disappointing. Like I said, you look at a lot of the Jags' top five picks, it is insane the bust rate that they have on the guys that they have selected. I think you're really looking at Dave Caldwell's job, in my mind, kind of teeters on whether or not Bortles can figure this thing out. And I think that's why you've seen the Jaguars ride with him for as long as they have, just because if Bortles is gone, guess who's going with him? Probably Caldwell. So, you know, this is an interesting situation. It's tough. I don't know what the Jags are going to do with Dante. It'll be interesting to see. But he's got a lot of things to prove. And to be honest, the weight that he's been carrying and putting on the Jaguars' mind is just, it's not in correlation with his production on the field. So in my mind, he's a guy that's very expendable at this point.
It was, as Dante Fowler Jr. said on draft night, Duval, you got a Gator. And outside of Fred Taylor, it looks like it's going to end the way most Gators at Jacksonville go. In a lot of disappointment and a lot of annoyance. And a lot of money spent for nothing. We're putting a ball in it after this. Wake Up War Chant, 97.9 ESPN Radio.
Wake Up War Chant on 97.9 ESPN Radio is presented by TNT Golf Cart Supercenter, your one-stop shop for all your outdoor entertainment. Here's Ryan Kelly.
Putting a ball on it, Wake Up Board Chant, 97.9 ESPN Radio, brought to you by our friends at For the Table, Madison Social, Central, and Township. Hope you made it out to Winstein Wednesday. Had some proof lager, some good times out there last night. Did want to mention before we run, something pretty crazy happened in Major League Soccer last night. No team in the history of Major League Soccer has ever come down from a 3-goal deficit to win a match. I mean, we know blowouts are pretty uncommon in soccer, especially at higher levels, club levels. Germany-Brazil may be the biggest blowout, at least in terms of notoriety, when that happened in the World Cup a couple years back, when Germany beat Brazil 7-1 in 2014. But club level, super, super blowouts are rare. Blowout comebacks are really rare. And that's why when the Seattle Sounders scored 4 goals in a matter of, I believe it's 27 minutes in the second half last night, kind of makes your jaw drop. That does not happen. Like, think about that. That's like scoring 4 touchdowns in 5 minutes. It doesn't happen. But cool stuff. Cool win. Go check out those highlights just to watch that stadium go nuts, if you like such a thing. Drew, my thanks to you, my friend.
Thank you.
Thanks to you guys for listening. Mike and Mike's up next, 97.9 ESPN Radio.
War
WarChant.com is the ultimate inside source for FSU football and recruiting. And now you can get in on the action for free for an entire month. WarChant.com is offering a risk-free 30-day trial subscription. Get full access to the number one website covering the Seminoles just by entering the promo code WARCHANT30. That's WARCHANT30. Sign up and get in on the world's most active FSU message boards. Receive breaking news, stories from our award-winning staff, plus get exclusive interviews and videos. Just enter the promo code WARCHANT30. WARCHANT.com, your ultimate Seminole sports source.
Hey, thanks for downloading today's show. If you haven't already, why don't you rate and subscribe us? We certainly do appreciate it, and of course, we appreciate you listening anyway, so just go ahead and click that right there. You know you want to. Come on. Come on. Thanks again for letting us do the show. We love giving you all the football, basketball, baseball, recruiting, all year round. Not just football season, not just spring practice, but hopefully giving you the freshest and newest FSU content every day. Thanks, guys.